seem to, I see in your spirit, there's just been this, just this rocking back and forth. Trying to, I'm clamoring. I get the word clamoring going on. There's just been this clamoring going on in your spirit. God is taking away. He's erasing the clamor and the clutter. And joy, unspeakable and full of glory, is what you'll start. You'll be driving around that mail truck and kidding. I believe in Jesus' name, you'll be pulling the side of the road, but the spirit of laughter is going to start hitting you. And what happens when you laugh? Takes place. See, some of us just need a good dose of the Holy Ghost. I like that little song that goes, just one dose of the Holy Ghost ain't good enough for me to know yourself. Thank you. you to use the gift that he's given you. And he's wanting to show that. So I'm just going to obey God. I'm going to do my part. And he wants you to do your part. So let him to reme sike. Bureme in chiki rosta blasti. Que bede o correme niniche. Cade los bre in dombu. Vezo gre in dreba. Sike rosta. Misik brota andire curie e a sake frago sike gelle goria mum ye della rose va ba alche ka ela kondra masa le breste che pubra in dogorie sia ka la rahera ka la na ka hasis kan de she tu ve sike bamba te ki do bre mo la ela kata ye ke shes ka vasi Voste mia che da bailo e che c'è lo stai, lo stai, lo stai. Thank you.
My children, I find favor in you. This is just a glimpse of what I have for you in the future. You can't even comprehend what you have in store for you. I'm building you up. I have brought you from small places, but now you're moving into larger places. And it's getting bigger and bigger, and it's like a snowball. It's rolling and it's rolling. Don't ever stop and think that this is where it ends. Because you do not know, you can't comprehend what I have for you. There is so much more. You're walking little by little, step by step, precept by precept. Your faith is going to increase. When you start praising me in all the glory, I am in the midst. And your faith is going to become strong, and you're going to start walking in the believer's authority. You're going to have the authority to come forth and do those things that I left for you here on earth. I said, I go to be with the Father, but greater things you're going to do. And you're not even going to flinch. You're going to stand strong, and you're going to say, that is for me. I can do those things. And you're going to step out in faith, and you're going to believe to receive. And you're going to see signs and miracles come upon you as you have never seen before. It's going to go forth in this city. And as I have said before, it is no longer the queen city of the Highlands, but the king city of the Highlands. And you will be blessed. Your children will be blessed. Your seed will be blessed. As I said to Father Abraham, as he considered himself not, his wife, he did not consider her barren. He did not consider him not even to be barren. But you will go forth and you will believe and say, I will go forth in the power and the might of Jesus Christ. And we give you the praise and the glory this day. And we just thank you for all the goodness and the blessings and every need that this church has. It's coming into being. I have brought you from small places, as I have said before. Look what I have done in your body in just the last year. Next year, you will see even bigger and better things. Do not look at what the world has and what the world has done and what it's doing. I'm greater than that. I have overcome the world, and the enemy is under your feet. And you're going to walk in that power. Thank you, Father. Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Do not be deceived, my children, because I come before you and I want you to know that my word says that where two or more are gathered in my name, I am there with you. Do not be deceived about this word that has been given, as written in my word. Don't be deceived. Don't let Satan deceive you. Because if you are a believer, I live inside you. There is always two of you walking in the earth as long as I am with you. So always, whether you're by yourself or you're with 100, remember that you, when you are alone, there's two always there. So Father God, I just thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Now, interpretation can have up to 3 interpretations, for example. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Our tongue can have up to 3 interpretations. Thank you, Lord.
I did receive some words out of that. The Church of Corinth. One of the reasons why Paul went to started worshiping the world. And Paul had to go here and told him not. And this is what I got out of what I heard the Lord say was there's no gray area at the
church. Amen.
No gray area at the
church. No gray area. Praise God. So what do you do after that? Well, you just take it. Judge all the words, praise God. How many? Do I think there's more of us? Yes. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We received those words this morning. Anybody else? God may be speaking to you individually today. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. All right. I guess let's receive our tithes and offerings this morning. Praise God.
Amen.
As we're in this attitude of worship, we want to be in the attitude of worship this morning. Praise. So, if you need an offering envelope this morning, remember your cash offerings. Let's pass it out. That way we keep up with everything. And you want it for your year-end taxes, if anybody needs them, come along. In case I failed, I think last week I said something, but you are also, we can do credit cards here, so you got a check card or something, and some people go, oh man, I forgot my cash, but I got my card, so we can run that too, so we're set up for that. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Well, all right. We have our offering up there, our offering. Confession we do.
Oh, no.
There's baby. There we go. All right. Here we go. Let's make this offering confession this morning. Praise God. Shout it out. As we receive today's tithes and offerings, we are believing the Lord for jobs and better jobs. Raises and bonuses, benefits, sales and commissions, favorable settlements, estates and inheritances, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, finding money, bills paid off, bills decreased, blessing and increase. We thank you, Lord, for meeting all my financial needs, that I may have more than enough to give to the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, those who don't know, we've had testimonies, especially the home church when we first started doing that. This one here in particular, this was given to us by Dick Mills. And I mean, we had tests. We've even had it here, praise God. We've had checks in the mail coming, finding money, bills paid off, everything. And it's awesome, man, when you get the word of God on your lips and begin to confess that. Praise God. All right. So I'm believing this week that's going to happen to you. Amen. Because we're believing. So, amen. Father, this morning we thank you for our tithes and our offerings. We receive it, Father. unto you. We come and we give back what belongs to you today. And we thank you for blessing this house. That, Lord, this house is blessed. That, Lord, Father, every single cent goes into your kingdom. Father, we want to be able to, as we build, we want to be able to help people and have that benevolence system set up, Lord, to go out and touch people and help people, Father. We thank you that's part of it. We thank you, Lord, that our lights are paid. We thank you the water is paid. We thank you the rent on the building's paid. We just praise you for that this morning. And we give you glory and honor for it. That we get to bring it back into your house today. And Lord, just as we were singing, the floodgates of heaven's open over us today. That you've rebuked the devourer for our sake. We receive it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah.
Where'd you get that one from? That wasn't in the cans. Praise God. Hallelujah. I am excited. I do want to say this. I am excited about us getting ready in the next couple of weeks or so, getting ready to teach the believer's authority to you. And let me say this. You need to be here.
Amen.
For that. You know, I was telling Mike alone this morning, I was talking to pastors also out in Terry, and I said, you know, I said, until we get the believer's authority in you, knowing who you are as a believer, almost no other message will even mean anything to you until you actually get a hold of the believer's authority. Knowing who you are in Christ Jesus, knowing what He gave you and gave to you. And so in the next couple of weeks, we're excited. As I said, I'll preach it on the Sunday morning. Carrie will teach it on Sunday night. And man, we're going to do good stuff at night. We're going to give you homework, everything else. It's going to be like going to school. Why? We want you to get this in your spirit.
Amen.
And I said, so awesome. I said, so cool. You know, when you hear from God, you better hope your pastor's hearing from God, by the way. I said, you know, you got some bunch out there that don't believe that God talks to you. And I'm talking about churches, denominations. There's a couple of denominations that I don't think God talks to you. Well, all God was going to say was right here in the Bible, and He's not going to speak to you. Well, you better hope you got a pastor that God speaks to you. Amen. Just like this morning, praise God. Hallelujah. Now, I didn't sit up all night and think that stuff. Well, number one, yes, my mind can if I wanted to. I'm going to say that. I'm training myself not to say those negative things. Praise God. But, you know, I how I used to be, I used to say that all the time. As a joke, I would go, I'm just an old burnout. I can't remember that. Well, I was saying that stuff. And confessing that junk, man. And then God got a hold of me and says, I renew your mind daily.
That's right.
You're not a burnout.
Amen.
No matter how many drugs you did, you're not a burnout. And, you know, I started getting corrected on that. Because it started out being a little ha-ha, just a little joke, you know, about my past. You know, it was becoming real. You know, and I mean, I'm talking about I start forgetting stuff. And then, just daily, you know. And here's Carrie to remember stuff from the first day we met. You know, I'm going, huh? Or is that typical of all men? I don't know. I forgot where we were at. We were out somewhere, and I forgot what you said. I forgot what you said, but it'd been like a week had passed by. She took up a conversation that we had like a week ago. And just went back into it like we were still in the conversation. I went, huh? I was like, what are you talking about? Last week you said, she went into this conversation like we were just got through talking about it or something. I'm like, what in the world are you talking about? I don't even have no idea. I done forgot, man. But anyhow, you know, I'd be like that, but man, God got a hold of me and God says, you know what? You have the mind of Christ.
Amen.
You're not a burnout. You have the mind of Christ. And everyone sitting in this room, you've got the mind of Christ. The Bible says, as a matter of fact, that the memory of the just is blessed.
Yep.
Praise God. The memory of the just is blessed. And so you're blessed. Your memory is blessed this morning. But I'm excited to be getting on this series when we get into it. We're taking it to the prison. We're going to preach it to the guys in the prison. I'm going to preach it to you guys. That's why I want you to be here for it. And you need to be here Sunday morning and Sunday night. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Because you're going to get one aspect from me and one aspect from Carrie. And so praise God. Be here for that. And we'll get more stuff out about it as we get closer to it. We've been speaking on the word that God gave me about five loaves and two fishes. This church was like the five loaves and two fishes. And you know, as I was preaching, I remember going back. I said it was somewhere around this spot right here. I was standing when God just dropped that in me, downloaded that in my spirit, praise God. And that your church is like you are like the five loaves and five fishes. Amen. You're about to be multiplied.
Amen.
And you're about to feed thousands, praise God. Well, man, I need that. As I said, I took that and I just started praying over that. I was like, I got to get more into that, what God's trying to tell us. But let's look at Verse 30, we'll start verse 30 and read down here until we get to my next verse. We'll stop at verse 34 for a second. And the apostles gathered themselves together unto Jesus, and he told them all things, both what they had done, what they had taught. And he said to them, come you yourselves into a desert place and rest a while. Praise God. That's where so many ministers today, even pastors, miss it a lot of times. We got into this ritual thing. We got into this religious thing that pastors got to go, 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 go. And they do. Don't get me wrong. A pastor's job is 24/7. Amen. But where so many ministers miss it at is they don't take time to rest. You know the enemy can use that against you. You'll get so busy for the kingdom of God, he will wear you out. And you're thinking the whole time, oh, this is God, this is God. I'm going 24-7, bless God. 24-7, no rest, nothing. And, well, the devil's got you in his hand because he's going to wire you out.
That's right.
And that's why so many pastors, you see them in some of the mental hospitals, you see them quitting the ministry, giving up and quitting, shutting their churches down. Is what happened. They went through a phase of burnout, where they didn't take the time to rest. Well, we see Jesus rested. Amen. We should take our example from that. And he told the disciples here to rest. But there is times, you know, when Karen and I want to rest, we intend to rest, but, you know, this compassion in our heart, it overrides the rest a lot of times. And we see somebody in need, and I'll never forget the time whenever one of my first big deals when I was over pastoral care at the home church, man, it was on Thanksgiving Day. We're just sitting down with your family on Thanksgiving Day. We were still at my grandparents' house, I think, and we were about to have a meal, and all of a sudden, my pager goes off, you know? And that was my first big deal of leaving the family and taking off, and this has been years back, but taking off and going to the hospital to meet someone else's need. They were put in the hospital, had an emergency. And I remember walking through those doors. Well, they were expecting, they just put it on the prayer request line. You know, of course, I would immediately get the prayer request and all that. And I would send it out to all the prayer groups. Everybody's, we had a phone system where your phone number was in our system in our prayer groups, our life groups and all that. Well, they would get whenever I'd get the prayer request, especially with urgent prayer requests, well, I immediately send it out to all our elders and deacons and all that stuff in the church and the leaders in the church, and I would send that out. Well, it was Thanksgiving Day, and this family wasn't expecting nobody to show up at the hospital. But, man, I come through there, you know, and I saw them sitting there, and I just had this big grin on my face, you know. Hey, she said, man, she goes, you'll never know in a million years what that meant to our family. You come walking through that door on Thanksgiving Day, you know. And it wasn't just because it was part of the job. It was the compassion I had, you know, for the people. And still do have that for the people today. We want to be here for you. That's what, you know, Karen and I, we made this decision on time. And actually, Karen said, you know, the people aren't supposed to be. Some churches you go to, pastor thinks you're supposed to serve them. And they've got people that have, pastors today have got that backwards. Pastors are to serve you. Karen and I are here to serve you, praise God. And that's great for the teams we get and the leaders we get and all that. And the staff we get as we build up, as we get bigger. Hallelujah for that. But you know, Karen and I's job is here to serve you. And we mean that. When we took that on, you know, when God spoke to us to come to this city, we took that on. And we're coming to serve the people, praise God. And they're not coming to serve us. And we serve. We want to serve you, praise God, and be here for you. And so people miss that. Pastors miss that a lot. But that's why we'll take the phone calls early in the morning. Now, don't be calling, just be calling. You know, Pastor Allen gives a story of a guy one time called him at 3 o'clock in the morning. He said, hey, Pastor, are you up? The pastor said, no, man, I was just laying in here in bed at 3 o'clock in the morning waiting on your call. You know? And the guy, he didn't have anything wrong. He just wanted to call. See what Pastor was up to 3 o'clock in the morning. You know? Well, we don't want them kind of phone calls. But if you need prayer, praise God, we're here to pray for you. Amen? We're here 24-7, 7 days a week for you, glory to God. But here's what happened. They departed to a desert place, in verse 32, in the ship privately. And the people saw him departing, and many knew him, and ran afoot thither from the cities, and out with them, and came together unto him. Verse 34, and Jesus, when he came out, saw much people, he was moved with compassion toward them, because they were as sheep, not having a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. In other words, that compassion, he was stirred. What happened? He was, when he saw the people, he saw the multitude of people, he was stirred to take action. And that's where I am in my life today. When I see this city, I see this city hurting. And I see people in this city hurting. And I move with compassion to help them. And we're moved with compassion to minister into their lives and see their lives change. I don't want to see people walking around in despair. I don't want to see people walking around disappointed. I don't want to see people walking around in poverty. I don't want to see people walking around in sickness and disease. Amen? When God sent us to the city, praise God, we come to do exactly what he told us to do. To preach the good news to them. Amen? The good news is they don't have to be sick anymore. They don't have to be poor anymore. You don't have to walk around in disappointment anymore. Praise God. And that's the message that he sent us to this city today. Praise God. So I move with compassion. How about the church? Are you moved to compassion this morning? Yeah. When you see somebody in need, or you just, you know, walk on by. You know, you see somebody needing something, you got a brother and sister, or you know somebody in the church that has a need, but we don't do anything. See, I don't want to be that kind of church. We know somebody's in need. But we're not talking about somebody that's there trying to take advantage of. But you know what? I've got this house too. There may be people there to take advantage of you. But sometimes God still wants you to plant in their life.
Amen.
You know? I remember going downtown and the alcoholics and the homeless people down there. Well, many of them were there to take advantage of you. You know why? They didn't want to change. They had no desire in their hearts. Many of them, some did. But for the most part, many of them had no desire in their heart to change. They just wanted your money. You know? They just wanted you to give them that, you know, $10 or $5, whatever it was. But still, you know, we'll be downtown, you'll see the people sitting, you know, especially ones you see standing on the sidewalk or on the sidewalk, you'll see them standing out there by the freeway and stuff, and they're holding their, you know, hungry, please give food, you know, whatever. Have you ever wanted to point to one of them people that says, we'll work for food, and just say, what are you willing to do, you know? You come, won't come mow my grass, you know, just sit there and do it. And you got some that'll do it, you know. Now, that's about, I'm sorry, I'm just fooling people like this. But, you know, we'll work for food, you know. Hey, you want to come repair my house? I'll give you some food, man. You want to wash my car for me? Something like that. But I'm just joking on that part. But I am moved with compassion. You know, we're moved with compassion. And when we see people, that's indeed. You know, you don't have to. It's like Joyce said when we were watching the other night. You know, you don't have to. You don't have to get a word from the Lord to help somebody.
Right.
Just be good to somebody, praise God, and bless them. And if it means taking a bite of that person, you don't have. You see somebody standing on the side of the road, you don't have to go, well, God didn't tell me. Well, yeah, in a way he did. He said, when I was hungry, you came and fed me. When I was in prison, you came and saw me. When I was sick, you came to minister to me. So he's already told you that when you do it to the least of these, you've done it unto me, praise God. So it don't take a revelation word from God or a boom of lightning from heaven, you know, to say, you know, to this person. You know? No. It's in the heart. It's a heart thing, praise God. And we're moved by compassion. And for this whole city, I want to see every person. I want to see every homeless person in a place to live. Amen. Well, if they don't want to, well, then they'll live on the street. But, you know, those that want to change, that's not coming to church. People come to church all the time. You know how many people sitting on the front row? Not y'all, but.
Yeah.
You know how many people are sitting in churches a day? They go just because it's the ritual thing to do. It's just out of habit we go. They have no intention of changing their life. And man, they'd be some of your best amenners, man. But they have no intention of, changing their lifestyle. You know? Some people are stuck in poverty. They like poverty, and they're going to stay in poverty. They ain't going to change. Some people are sick. They like to be sick. They're not going to change. Some people are disappointed or depressed. And you would not believe the people who love to be depressed. I've been around a ton of people who love to be depressed, man. And no matter how much encouragement you try to give them, they ain't going to come out of that. They're not going to come out of that depression. They like being there. And so your churches are filled with people like that today. You got people who are sitting in your churches today that don't want to change their life, man. I like the party lifestyle. And I'm going to come to church and do the right thing on Sunday, but through the week, I'm going to live like hell. Mm-hmm. I know. We know people like that. No matter how many Bible verses they put up through the week, you know, on their texting and their Facebook pages and all that, inside they don't want to change. So I'm moved by compassion. I want to see people change, praise God. So Jesus overlooked his personal needs for rest and food at the time. And we don't know, we get so, in our Western world, we are so absorbed in ourselves a lot of times that we don't see people. See, we got to go beyond these. People have this mentality, this buy forward, no more mentality. You've got churches today. I know churches. I know people that go to some churches and bless God, they better not no visitor come to that door. We got who we want coming here. We don't want no visitors. This is a family church ran by a family, and nobody else is going to come in and be a part of it. You know? You really mean that, Pastor? Yeah. We know church. I preached at a church one time that it was ran by two sisters ran the whole church. They told the pastor what to do. They told they okayed, not okayed everything that happened in the church. They were over the tithes and the offerings. They handled everything. Two sisters. Now the church was a small church. And that was actually the place I went to, and I preached one night, and I got up and I said, now, I'm not long-winded, praise God. I said, I'm not long-winded. I said, an hour and 45 minutes, I would still go. I didn't get asked back. So, or did I? Did I get asked back? I can't remember. It was one of the Church of God churches in Dalton, but I can't remember. I think I might got asked back. But you know, it was blessed. That pastor was so blessed that we came. And I was blessed by just, you know, what he said. It was such a blessing. And Pastor Jackie, he said, man, he goes, I didn't expect you to accept our invitation. We're just a little small church. And, and at the time, back in that day, I mean, River of Life, you know, we were known all over the place, man. It was, and so the pastor said, he goes, man, he goes, you come to our church, it's like Brother Copeland coming through our doors. And I said, well, praise God, hallelujah. I ain't Brother Copeland, but thank you, Jesus, hallelujah. But that meant the world to that pastor, you know. Amen. Now, he only lasted about two more years, and they ran him off. Praise God. Because he got a hold of the faith message. Man, he was trying to teach people faith. They didn't want to hear it. Again, they did not want to change. We got to get out of our self-absorbed atmosphere that we're in, praise God, and start thinking about others. You know, that's what's going to change this city. Yeah. Amen. When we quit thinking about ourselves and we start thinking about others. Yeah. And see, faith is an action word. Faith is an action word. We just sit there and go, whoa, bless God. You know, I know churches today that talk about preaching and they go, you know what, bless God, this world needs to, you know, you hear, this world needs to be saved, praise God. This city needs to be saved. You don't ever see them go out. It's they need it, they need it, but we're not doing nothing to help them. You know? I want to be like Pastor Allen said, bless God, we are not a sit ye church, we are a go ye church.
Right.
He said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel, praise
Amen.
God. Now I'm not stopping there.
Amen.
We're going on like how we preached a couple weeks ago. Amen. We don't just stop on preaching the gospel to all the world. Amen. We go on beyond that, what Jesus said. Miracles come at a cost. Miracles come at a cost. And you got to look around. Look around you, praise God. Look at those that let your eyes will be open, that God will show you. Man, you can be a miracle in somebody's life. Mm-hmm. You can be that person, I mean, you know, that encouraging word to that person. Whenever somebody walks up and, I mean, like I said last week, you could be standing in a supermarket, you could be standing at Walmart, you know, wherever, Lowe's, Home Depot, you know, wherever you're at. Even the little car hops that come up to the side, man, you can bless one of them. One day.
Mm-hmm.
Just give them an encouraging word, you know, straight from heaven, amen, that can change their, one word from God, as Brother Copeland says, one word from God can change a life forever.
Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Miracles require you to take the initiative in faith. Now, here's what Jesus said. Look at verse 36, or verse 35. And when a day was far spent, his disciples came to him and said, this is a desert place, and now the time is far past. Send them away, that they may go into the country round about and into the villages to buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat. Now, isn't that something? The disciples see that. The disciples say they have need. The people need. That'd be like me walking in here on Sunday morning knowing you're in need of, you know, spiritual things. I'm just going, well, bless God. Glad you came to church this morning. You put your tithes and offerings in here. Okay, see y'all. That's almost like what the disciples were thinking. It's like, well, praise God, they've been here. Well, it's time to go now. It's late, so just send them off. We ain't got nothing here. We can't feed them. We know they're getting hungry, God. Just send them away. No, we're not going to turn anybody away, praise God. And so miracles come, and of course you've got to take the initiative in faith. So they say, hey, send them away. Basically what the disciples were saying, God, we see a problem here, but it ain't our problem. How many of us have said that? It ain't my problem. Well, I know they're facing this, and I know they're, you know, they're having a hard time with this, but it ain't my problem. Well, yeah, it affects your attitude. That's a stinking attitude.
Amen.
That's right.
It is your problem. It should be your problem.
That's right.
You see a brother or sister in need, it should be your problem to help them fix it, praise God. And to speak into their lives today. In verse 37, he answered and said to them, give ye them to eat. And they said to him, shall we go and buy 200 penny worth of bread and give them to eat? I looked that up right there, and that penny worth. You know what that is? In today's times, that was about $8,000. That's about $8,000. And so, first thing on their mind was, how much is it going to cost? Hey, things come at a cost sometimes with the gospel saved. Mm-hmm. Amen? And what better way to plant into somebody's lives? If I don't plant money, man, it's going to be into some people's lives, praise God. And he says, you give them to eat. Jesus offers the opportunity to extend faith and move into the miracles. And until we're willing to engage in meeting the needs of others, we won't see miracles. Until we're willing to engage in the lives of others. Oh, God, just, Lord, let us have a miracle. That's why I believe this church, because I can't tell you how much, you know, the seed we plant into the prison, the seed that we plant into the meals given to the prison, the benevolence that we've given out. There's people that, you know, we give to here. They don't come to church here. We want them to come to church here. We want to help them out. But we got some, and then there's some people, man, sometimes I feel like these people are just taking advantage of us. But you know what? It's called the love factor.
Amen.
It's loving them and looking beyond that. And, you know, if something's been stolen from you, praise God, hallelujah. Like Joyce Meyer said the other night, you know, if something's been stolen from you, somebody has stolen from you. That's what Jesus is saying right here. Hey, whenever you're going and somebody asks for your coat, give them both of them. Because what you're doing, you're giving, they ain't taking.
That's right.
They ain't taking nothing from you. So what you do is go, you know what? Lord, this, you know, whatever, these finances or something from your home or something that was stolen, our house has been broken into twice.
Sorry.
You know, what? Oh, no, okay. So, no, I'm kidding. I was playing. Our house has been broken into twice. Teenager broke into our house, you know? And there's a certain item right now that we've never gotten back that was a family heirloom. And so we just plan, we're just believing in Jesus' name. You know, I forgot who it was. They're talking about someone's home was broken into one time, and the item was stolen. It was an engagement ring or something, and they had it for however long it was. But this ring was stolen. They began praying and believing God. And I think like 15, 16 years have passed by. You know? Well, why would you believe that thing's gone? It's been pawned. It's probably done been melted. You know? Or somebody else is wearing it. They believed for almost 16 years for that ring. They go, no, that's my ring. That's my property. And in Jesus' name, I'm getting it back. Now, that's called authority. And so they believed and believed and believed, and sure enough, I forgot how the story happened, but a box came in the mail or something. I forgot what it was. And that was that ring after 16 years. Somebody returned it. Amen. After 16 years, somebody returned that ring, man. And then praying and believing. Well, then sometimes we've had things stolen from us, we just plant it, man. But we're still believing for that item to come back to us. Somehow. Not that, you know, probably not a day goes by, whatever. I don't think about it. And I just say in Jesus' name, that item's coming back to us in the name of Jesus. I don't know who has it. I don't know where it's at now. I don't know whose homes it's in right now. But in Jesus' name, it's going to get back to us. I really believe that. Praise God. Don't limit. Miracles require you to do what you can. Verse 38, we'll get ready to close here. As I said, I'm going to keep everybody alone. Verse 38, he said, how many loaves have you? Go and see. And when they knew, they said, 5 loaves and 2 fishes. So what Jesus was saying, what do you have? Go and see what you have. You know what? What do you have here? It's not about how much you got. It's about what have you got?
Amen.
What have you got? Because what's about to happen here is he's about to take this and he's about to multiply. So what do we have? What do you have today that Jesus can take and multiply? Well, I don't have a lot of talent, you know. Well, what do you got?
That's it.
What do you got? Well, I don't think I seem real good. Well, take your talent. Let him use it. Let him multiply. Well, you know, I do this, I do that, you know, but I'm not really. Well, let it take what you got.
Yeah.
If you want to plant a financial, well, I don't, you know, hey, stop doing this. I hear people sometimes say this. This is all I got. They want to give an offering or whatever. This is all I got. Quit saying that. Let God take that.
Amen.
And multiply that.
Yeah,
praise God. I don't care if it's a penny.
Amen.
Or two. If that's all you got, then bless God. Sow it, bless God. And watch Jesus multiply. We don't have to go in the store of the lady with the 2 pence, Lord. We know that story. Don't limit what God can do. God expects you to do what you can. Make yourself available. Make what you have count. Make what you have count today. And then let me ask this final question here. Are you available? Are you available? There's a song back in the early 90s by Petra called I Am Available. I love that song. Cool song. I will go where you say go. I'll do what you tell me to do. I'm just available. So here I am, Lord. Send me. Praise God. Here I am. Send me. Allow God to begin to use you today. Allow God to take your talents. Allow God to take your gifts and begin to use them for the kingdom of God. So you know the story about the person who sat on their talents. They didn't have them any longer. So allow God to use your talents today. Praise God. I want to encourage you today about that. Hallelujah. So thank you, Jesus. Next week, praise God, we're going to talk about how miracles require you to speak and act. Miracles will require you to speak and act. So we cut it just a little bit short, but I'm just going by the Holy Ghost here, praise God. And we just go as long as the Holy Ghost tells us to. Thank you, Jesus. When he says quit, we quit. He says keep on going, just keep on going. Amen. Carrie and I say it, we say it now. We're only going to do what we see the Father do. We're only going to say what we hear the Father say. Amen. I'm not going to add to, take away nothing. Bless God. I just want to be pure. And pure, and I have said this from the very beginning. We just want to be transparent before the people. Bless God. That's what I love about our pastors. Amen. Transparent. Just be transparent before the people. Bless God. And we learned that from them. We want to do the same. Bless God, we're not doing nothing, but what you see here is what you see at home. Amen. And that's what I love about our boys. There's one thing they'll testify to. Now we're like any other family, you know. Carrie tries to fuss with me and I won't do it. And, you know, we're all that. I'm just kidding. We're like with any other family. Of course, that temptation of us and all that stuff, not like anybody else. So you got that kind, you know. We're normal people, bless God. But other than that, what you see here is what you see at home. And our kids, all three of our kids will testify to that. And that mom and dad aren't different at home. They don't live one way at home and live a different way at church. I mean, you can ask any of them now. And they'll be honest with you before that. You know, one of the greatest things one of my sons said, I think it was Josh, our oldest son, he said, one thing I appreciate about Dad, and I'm still the same way. He said, one thing I appreciate about Dad was, you know, when Dad would get on to me or something, and he was wrong for getting on to me. There was times I did that, you know. I messed up, and, you know. He said, one thing I loved about Dad would come back in my room and apologize. And say, son, I'm sorry, I was wrong with what I did. I was wrong with getting on you for that. You didn't deserve it, you know, for me to do that. And he said, I love that about that. I love that about that. And we were with him last night, praise God. So we had fun at Outback, glory to God. And all you can eat shrimp. The waitress, when she'd come by, she'd say, did they not bring your shrimp? I was like, yeah, it's done gone. Give me another one. And she almost every time she comes, she goes, oh no, she goes, they're not bringing your shrimp yet? I was like, yeah, I done ate it. Give me another one. I was like, you know, a little 10 pieces of shrimp's gone in 3 seconds. So, you know, we can go all night eating shrimp, man. Praise God. So glory to God, we had a good time. But